Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Mr. Dejoy, again, thank you for being here today. You know, I just want to start off before asking some questions, just making it very clear that the men and women who work at the Postal Service, who check in every day to do their jobs, do it with professionalism, with integrity, and a passion to move the mail as quickly and as efficiently as possible. When I think of the postal workers, the mail handlers, the letter carriers, they're doing a great job. They are clearly essential workers each and every day. But as we've been going through this issue, and I've talked to many of those folks across my state, they have grown increasingly frustrated with some of the recent policies that have come in place, which they say is nothing that they've seen in the past. And they believe that mail has been piling up in ways that it shouldn't. And it needs to be addressed. But these are management changes. These are policy changes. It's not the men and women who are on the front line doing this this work every day. So my question, or so Postmaster General Dejoy, you've already heard me in my from folks all across Michigan, but really across the country. Folks have sent in their concerns to me. Earlier in my opening statement, I shared some stories of hardships from folks, both Beth and Mary, their challenges in Michigan. So, and I think I heard this in the last answer. You acknowledge that some of the changes that were put in place have delayed the mail, and with a delay in mail, people can sometimes be hurt. Is that true?
Senator, first of all, I do recognize the quality capability of the American postal worker. That's one of the reasons that I'm here, is to help. As well as with regard to the Postal Service's key role in serving the American public. Yes, sir, I do recognize that some of these, there's been two changes. The organizational change has had no, I don't believe has any impact on what we've done. The transportation change, getting into compliance with our schedule.
Mr. Jordan, let me just jump. I don't want to mean to cut you off, but I'll get into those issues because I want you to elaborate a little bit further. But there have been delays. You'll recognize that. You know, it's clear what we're seeing. Mail's been delayed, and I've spent over a month asking you to provide some documentation, kind of in my oversight function here in this committee, to how you made these decisions, what kind of analysis, what sort of data was put in place, and for that, and how that information impacted some of the changes you have. Your staff has repeatedly not answered those questions, and so certainly that transparency, I think, is unacceptable. What I have uncovered, though, from what little data is made public by the Postal Service, is on-time mail delivery. And I have my chart as well here, too, which is from the Eastern Division. This is what you give to your business customers. And if you look at this line here, if it's probably hard to see, but there is a red line, which you can see, dipping dramatically. There's a flat line along the top of the chart, then it drops. Around July 11th, you start seeing the drop. July 18th, it falls dramatically. So that's a pretty big drop in on-time mail delivery that we are seeing. And I've asked for three times since July 17th for records relating to these service changes and how what I'm hearing from our letter carriers and postal workers and what I'm seeing in the chart that you actually post on your website, a significant drop of mail deliveries, and yet I don't get an answer. Will you commit to giving me these documents, which have to be readily available to the Postal Service by this Sunday? Can we get those documents to get a sense of what went into these decisions and what you're seeing in terms of mail delivery?
I will meet with our staff and get what documents with regard to this change. But the change, Senator, was to adhere to the transportation schedule. That was the change.
So I would just, obviously, you have all that documented. I'd love to see the documents as to how that was done, the data supporting that.
If I can add, there's two, and certainly there was a slowdown in the mail when our production did not meet the schedule. But also, Senator, our employees are experiencing the COVID pandemic. Also, and we have a significant issue in employee availability in many, many parts of the country that are also leading to delays in delivery and mail.
Let me turn to your recent announcement that you made this week, that you are suspending some of the changes that you had made over the last month. I believe the statement's fairly vague and it raises some additional questions. But I want to just be clear. These would be yes or no, just so we know exactly what was intended by that. Are you suspending your policy eliminating extra trips? Yes or no?
No. I did. First of all, the policy was not to eliminate extra trips. It was to mitigate extra trips.
Okay. So now to that. We're being told that you're limiting overtime, and this could possibly add to backlogs. Are you limiting overtime, or is that being suspended right now and people will work overtime if necessary to move the mail out efficiently every single day?
Senator, we never eliminated overtime. That's
curtailed significantly is what I understand.
It has not been curtailed by me or the leadership team here.
Curtailed significantly. It's gone down. It's been limited. Will you commit to
since I've been here, we've spent $700 million on overtime. Overtime runs at a 13% rate before I got here, and it runs at a 13% rate now. I did not.
If you have a policy, you can submit that to me. I'd appreciate it. Will you commit that there will be no post office closures or suspensions before November 3rd?
I confirm post office closures was not a directive I gave. That was around before I got here. There's a process to that. When I found out about it, and it had the reaction that we did, I've suspended that till after the election.
We've heard about the sorters. You addressed that earlier. Will you be bringing back any mail sorting machines that have been removed since you've become Postmaster General? Will any of those come back?
There's no intention to do that. They're not needed, sir.
So you will not bring back any processors?
They're not needed, sir.
Okay. I've got questions about independence and transparency. Prior to implementing the changes that you put forth in the postal system, did you discuss those changes or their potential impact on the November election with the president or anyone at the White House? And remind you, you're under oath.
I have never spoken to the president about the Postal Service other than to congratulate me when I accepted the position.
Did you speak or discuss any of these changes with Secretary Mnuchin?
During the discussion and negotiating the note, I told him I'm working on a plan, but I never discussed the changes that I made. I just said I'm working on a plan to improve service and gain cost efficiencies, but no grave detail other than that was about it.
Prior to implementing the changes, did you discuss these changes or their impact on the election with any Trump campaign officials?
No, sir. These changes in our total analysis here and going forward, and remember, I'm one new person in the organization with the whole structure around me, an operating structure, an executive team around me that are involved in these decisions, okay? And moving forward, trying to have any negative impact on the election is an outrageous claim.
Mr. Chairman, did you ever discuss any of this with Mark Meadows, any of these changes that you've done? You've never had discussion since you
haven't discussed anything with Mark Meadows. I haven't spoken to Mark Meadows up until maybe last week was the first time I spoke to him in a while.
So finally, you will give us your word today under oath that you have not taken any action whatsoever in your capacity as Postmaster General for any political reason or at the suggestion of any administration officials?
Sir, I will tell you, my first election mail meeting, what I instructed the organization, the whole team around us and out in the field, whatever efforts we will have, double them. I was greatly concerned about all the political noise that we were hearing, and I've had weekly reviews on this since before this all the excitement came out. We are very committed. The board's committed. The postal workers committed. The union leadership is committed to having a successful election. And the insinuation is quite frankly outrageous.
Just one final thing, Mr. Chairman. As we get into the election now, there has been concern that I'm hearing from state and local governments about first-class mail. Do you have your word that you're not going to mandate that states send out any ballots using either the more expensive first-class mail? And will you continue the processes and procedures to allow election mail to move as expeditiously as possible and treat it like first-class?
Yes, sir. we will deploy processes and procedures that advance any election mail, in some cases ahead of first class mail.
Okay, they won't charge local governments for the first class mail. They can continue the process that they've done in the past.
I don't get to charge anybody, but no, we're not going to change any rights.
Right. Thank you for the time. Thank you for the indulgence, Mr. Chairman, for the extra time.